Blackstone Audiobooks presents
Selected Poems by Lord Byron. From English Bards and Scotch Reviewers. Still must I hear, shall hoarse Fitzgerald bawl his creaking couplets in a tavern hall, and I not sing, lest haply Scotch Reviews should dub me scribbler, and denounce my muse? Prepare for rhyme, I'll publish right or wrong. Fools are my theme, let satire be my song. When vice triumphant holds her sovereign sway, obeyed by all who naught beside obey, when folly, frequent harbinger of crime, bedecks her cap with bells of every clime, when knaves and fools combined o'er all prevail, and weigh their justice in a golden scale, e'en then the boldest start from public sneers, afraid of shame, unknown to other fears, more darkly sin, by satire kept in awe, and shrink from ridicule, though not from law. Such is the force of wit, but not belong to me the arrows of satiric song. The royal vices of our age demand a keener weapon and a mightier hand. Still there are follies, e'en for me to chase, and yield at least amusement in the race. Laugh when I laugh, I seek no other fame. The cry is up, and scribblers are my game. Speed, Pegasus, ye strains of great and small, ode, epic, elegy, have at you all. I too can scrawl, and once upon a time I poured along the town a flood of rhyme, a schoolboy freak, unworthy praise or blame. I printed, older children do the same. 'Tis pleasant, sure, to see one's name in print. A book's a book, although there's nothing in't. Not that a title's sounding charm can save or scrawl or scribbler from an equal grave. This lamb must own, since his patrician name failed to preserve the spurious farce from shame. No matter, George continues still to write, though now the name is veiled from public sight. Moved by the great example, I pursue the self-same road, but make my own review. Not seek great Jeffreys, yet like him will be self-constituted judge of poesy. Time was, ere yet in these degenerate days, ignoble themes obtain mistaken praise, when sense and wit with poesy allied, no fabled graces flourished side by side. From the same fount their inspiration drew, and, reared by taste, bloomed fairer as they grew. Then in this happy isle a Pope's pure strain sought the rapt soul to charm, nor sought in vain. A polished nation's praise aspired to claim, and raised the people's as the poet's fame. Like him, great Dryden poured the tide of song, in stream less smooth indeed, yet doubly strong. Then Congreve's scenes could cheer, or Otway's melt, for nature then an English audience felt. But why these names, or greater still, retrace, when all to feebler bards resign their place? Yet two such times, our lingering looks are cast, when taste and reason with those times are past. Now look around and turn each trifling page, survey the precious works that please the age. This truth at least let satire's self allow, no dearth of bards can be complained of now. The loaded press beneath her labour groans, and printers' devils shake their weary bones, while Southey's epics cram the creaking shelves, and Little's lyrics shine in hot-pressed twelves. These are the themes that claim our plaudits now, these are the bards to whom the muse must bow, while Milton, Dryden, Pope, alike forgot, resign their hallowed bays to Walter Scott. The time has been when yet the muse was young, when Homer swept the lyre and Maro sung, an epic scarce 10 centuries.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.